The topic for today is at-risk students. And like I said earlier, I'm fortunate because I'm a supply teacher that I have an opportunity to work with many different demographics and many different types of students. And what I seem to be getting a lot of work in is students at risk. And the secondary school where I do most of my teaching, they have a Pathways program. I'm not sure if you're familiar with it, but it's where all the at-risk students form smaller class sizes. They have more or less one kind of core teacher that teaches them a few different subjects, or they at least try to have one or two teachers just teaching them, so the change is not as drastic as the mainstream. They have basically essential level classes in all their subjects. So I'd just like to do a little bit of discussion today on Pathways students and at-risk students. And I'd like to first take a quote out of the Holistic Learning and Spiritual Education textbook. On page 54, the quote says, "Positive childhood care that heavily relies on praise, caring touch, affection, and lack of violence or threats releases the chemicals dopamine and serotonin into particular areas of the brain, promoting emotional stability and mental health." Okay, another great way to increase dopamine and serotonin is physical activity. There's tons of research out there that shows that physical activity also aids the production of dopamine and serotonin. So this is where I'd like to start. The past few weeks, like I said, I've been in the Pathways classes, and it's course curriculum time. It's choosing our courses for next year. So every day I go into the students, I go into the classroom, that is the Pathways class, and I ask, what is your ideal curriculum? I put that on the whiteboard at the front of the classroom, big bold letters, and I put a big question mark, and we sat around and discussed the issues. And a day or two later, all the Pathway students were supposed to go pick their courses. So I asked them, well, who picked this course? And we were sitting, it was 9:30 a.m. Class started at 9, and we were in a history lesson today, but no one wanted to do history. And it's just trouble. It's just hard to get them to sit down at their desks, let alone learn history. So today was the history class. It was first period in the morning. We were even watching a movie. I thought, what could be more exciting than a movie in history? I was even engaged in the movie, and it was a current movie to boot. Anyways, of course, none of the students wanted to learn anything about history, and none of the students had anything to say about the curriculum and what is the ideal curriculum either. I had to pull teeth. It was like trying to pull teeth asking the students what they thought about curriculum and what they thought about courses and what type of courses they wanted. No one had any voice. No one wanted to say anything, which was very bizarre. And I was trying to convince them. I was trying to encourage them. And I said, listen, guys, you guys have to take your life by the necks here. You guys have to step up and be accountable for what you want to do. I said, this is your life. I said, you need to have some voice. You need to express your opinions. So we got into it a little bit more, and I started, doodling almost on the board and trying to make a mind map of some issues. And I talked about curriculum, and then we went into one-on-ones, and I asked some of the students. I asked Josh, for instance, who's has to see the probation officer once a week. He has to get shots in his arm once or twice a week for God knows what kind of drugs they're giving him, so the poor guy can sit in his chair and show up at school every day. And it's just, you really see the big picture when you have to work with these at-risk students and how bad or how non-productive schooling is for these students. So it's the two extremes, and I really think The holistic education is fitting in very nicely with my career right now. Anyways, I talked to a few students and I asked, what is your ideal curriculum? And a few of the students said, I'd like to take business because I'm interested in producing clothing. I'm interested in producing a brand of clothing, they were calling it. One of the students wanted to be a daycare worker. I asked, what do you guys want to do when you're older? And she said, I want to be a daycare worker. So I thought, you know, well, what better opportunity than now, than next year when you're picking out your courses, to try to find some parenting courses or some babysitting courses or some child-rearing courses. But of course, they don't have that in the curriculum because the curriculum only focuses on math, science, English, history, geography. Some of the students thought that they should, they'd love to learn about sports and be outdoors and do outdoors activities. Okay, one of the students wanted to do skating, he wanted to play hockey, he wanted to do baseball, he wanted to do sports and activities. And like we saw from the quote, okay, talking about dopamine and serotonin, physical fitness and activity also provides dopamine and serotonin, a feel-good chemical for the brain. And these students, at-risk students in grade 10, 15, 16 years old, some are 18, people that are really unsuccessful in school, are 18 years old learning grade 9 essential math. But I was just flabbergasted when they told me that they weren't in physical education. They had no phys ed. And it just baffled my mind. Like, no wonder we can't get these students to sit down at their desks all day. Why don't we run them around the track for a while in the morning? Or why don't we let them go up to the gym and pump some iron, or let them shoot hoops for an hour every day? And then we'll see how they do. I guarantee you they sit in their chairs the rest of the afternoon because they're so exhausted from working out and burning all sorts of energy. Anyways, to move on, a day later, it was a course selection day. So say the day before we were talking about curriculum because it was on the announcements and I wanted to strike up some conversation because I knew we weren't going to be doing anything that period anyways. It was history. First period was history. Second period was math. So basically it was my job to control these guys for 2 hours and to make sure there were no fights within the class. I'm a pretty easygoing teacher. Everyone likes me. They always ask for me to go into class because I don't enforce any of these ridiculous curriculum guidelines that they're trying to get teachers to conform to. So, I'm a little bit radical in that fact, but I think that's why I have a good rapport with these students, is because I kind of see where they're coming from. I kind of side with the students. Anyways, we were talking about classes and course selections, but no one wanted to pick any courses because they said that their courses have been picked for them all along. And since grade 9 and grade 10, they haven't had a choice in what they're learning. They've been told what they're learning. So I asked them, well, what are you going to do for next year when they're back out in the mainstream? They're going into grade 11 essential classes. And no one knows a kit and caboodle on what they're supposed to do next year. They're all scared. They all basically believe that they're going to fail. Okay, Louise, quote unquote, said, we will never make it. We're invisible, okay? And they're setting us up to fail, they said, because they've been so so hand-fed for the past 2 years in these special classes, essential classes, and now they're kicking them out of this Pathways program and they're trying to get them back into the mainstream. But they haven't been guided, and they haven't been mentored, and they haven't been shown how they can succeed in the mainstream, because all these students know and all they've ever been told is that they're terrible students, that they're brutal students, that they fail all the time, that they're no good. And how are we supposed to convince them that they'll do well in life? How are we supposed to convince these students that they'll succeed if everyone and everybody has told them that they're screw-ups and that they're not going anywhere? So I'm having this issue with these students, trying to get them to think on their own for a little bit. But they've never done it before. They've never thought on their own before. So how are they all of a sudden at 16 years old supposed to try and think on their own? It just doesn't line up properly. I mean, all their lives they've been told what to do. They've been told that they're bad. They've been told that they're no good. They've been told they're not going to succeed. All they've ever done is fail school. One of the quotes was, one of the students was, "I hate math. My mom's terrible at math." And then another one of the students during the history class said, "I don't give a rat's ass about history," he said. So how am I supposed to ask this student who's 16 years old to sit down at the desk and sit quietly, and he doesn't give a rat's ass, quote unquote, excuse my language, about history? Just doesn't make sense. It's just butting heads the whole time. I mean, the proof is in the pudding. I can see why these students haven't had success for so many years now, because they just don't care about the stuff they're learning and the stuff they're getting pushed into. And I can't really blame them right now. I mean, maybe it's time that we start listening to the students and we ask the students what they would like to take. I also asked Josh, one of the students in the class, you know, how did he learn how to type? Or we were talking about typing, or we were talking about, I asked about Facebook. That was it. And I said, you know, do you think we could learn on Facebook? And he said, yeah, Facebook's taught me a lot. I'm a great typer, he said. And I thought about it for a minute, and I said, well, absolutely. Because if he's always typing on Facebook, and he's typing, I mean, what's wrong with typing an essay and learning how to type, or following the guidelines on one of the A-D, A-S-D, F-G, or Facebooking your friends and actually having a conversation? Regardless of if it's conversation or not, he's learning how to type, he's learning how to look on the screen, he's learning how to be more productive. So is Facebook a bad thing? Should we be banning Facebook at schools? Should we be not letting the students go on Facebook to socialize, to learn how to type quicker, to read their messages? Isn't that literacy? Reading their friends typing, or typing onto their friends' Facebooks? Is that not literacy?